am Delaney Foster. I'm the founder of Unified Robotics, and I'm the CEO of Team 4911 Cybernetics from Seattle, Washington.
Hi everyone, I'm Tammy. I'm the member of the Cybernetics, and I'm also a member of Unified Robotics.
I'm a member of Cybernetics and I'm also part of the Unified Robotics program.
Hi, I'm Sarah Foster and I am a mentor on the Cybernetics and also the adult leading mentor for Unified Robotics. And I've got two daughters. One is Delaney and I have another daughter with special needs. And it was kind of the inspiration for this club was to combine both of those parts of our lives.
Next, we'll be showing a video that kind of briefly describes what Unified Robotics is and shows kind of from our team's aspect how we were impacted by this club.
Started by a student here at King's High School, Delaney Foster, and she really pioneered this idea of bringing robotics to students with disabilities.
I got the idea of Unified Robotics from my sister Kendall and her community sports clubs. My sister Kendall goes to Roosevelt High School and she's diagnosed with autism. She has a lot of my robotics team and she's my biggest fan. So I started doing research to see if there's any program that she could be involved in. And we weren't able to find any.
Because so many of the behaviors, it's hard to just say, well, it's this way.
At first they were pretty hesitant, yeah. Now they're very comfortable. And because the relationships that have been built between the peer mentors and the students.
Every week I'm so excited to see it. And I feel like I feel connections with the students who I work with. She's telling me what she's excited about, like her trip, first day school meal, and everything. She just become like part of my life, and I feel like I'm part of her life.
I really like him because we really work good as a team. Nobody's left out.
He just sees the way to put things together that no one else really knows, and it always works well. It's better than I could do.
Engineering is a possibility for me, potentially.
Sometimes it's hard to get them focused because they don't see the long-term goal, like they don't envision a robot running in their head, but once you get through the hard, painful steps, and they see the robot running on the ground, they get super excited.
Kendall is always telling me, oh, this is too hard, I can't do this, but we take it step by step and then we finally build the robot. So I think we really need to encourage a student to tell them that you can do this.
I was kind of interested in it before, but then when I started it, I was just like, holy cow, I'm really going to be excited to do it.
Personally, I think sport should be for everyone, and we consider robotics for the mind.
My ultimate goal is to connect FIRST Robotics with Special Olympics Unity Clubs so that we have Unified Robotics on a national level.
The whole purpose of FIRST is to get young students into math and science because I feel that this is really good at that.
The next Wednesday, we will bring in all the kids and everybody will start building their robot.
Yay!
Well, I just think that Unified is a really good program, and I'm glad to be part of it.
It was really meaningful to learn from them. I think I learned from them a lot.
club for students with for students with special needs to learn about robotics. And it was a 6-week long club this past fall. And we met once a week for about an hour and a half. And then at the end of the 6 weeks, we had a championship tournament where each robot played against each other and then there was a winner. We kind of set it up similar to how the first model is like. We got in mini teams and each team had a team name and a team cheer, and they all kind of worked on building their own robot, and then we had the ending tournament. And one thing that's really unique about this club is that it's one-on-one. The students from a robotics team work one-on-one with students from the special education department. And that aspect of it is really important in the whole inclusion aspect, because it shows that these students have the ability to build something. It gives them confidence. And every single member on our team was really impacted by this program. And that's why we have decided to bring it to a larger community and why we're here today.
So as you guys just heard Delaney talk about, you guys are probably very overwhelmed and excited about this program. I was at the exact same seat as you this last fall. Delaney came up with this idea and then she approached our team. And I think it sounds amazing and I wanted to do it. However, unlike Delaney, I don't have a sister who has special needs, and I have never in my life worked with anyone who has special needs. So I was a little scared coming into this program, but I think what really helped me is our team has an hour-long training with the special education department, and the teacher, they kind of coach us on how to find the speed that your student is working with, because we don't know any diagnosis of the student that we're working with. So I think it really helped me to through that lessons to kind of, with that, it helped me to know how the gist of what it will kind of feel like. And then the training ends with question and answer. And I am definitely the question kids in the room. I love to ask questions. I ask a lot of questions, and some of them are even really silly. But I encourage you guys, if you are doing this program, ask questions. It really helps. It can be like silly questions. For example, I ask, is there a student that I'm gonna work with, gonna put little Lego piece in their mouth, and if you're doing that, what I'm gonna do? It's just, I think that training really comforted me, and after entering the program, I worked with Delaney's sister, Kendall, and she has been such a blast in my life. And at first, I was a little scared, and I'm a very competitive person, and so I was trying to take control of how to build a robot, but Ken always will got distracted and go on sidetrack and talk about Disney's and what she's interesting, and I was just going, no, we got to do this robot. But as the time passed on, I find out the way how I take a step back, I let her take control, I let her to have her thinking go into the robots, and we talk about Disney's and her first day and her trip while we build robots. And I still remember the first day when her robot was on the ground running, and I'm 100 times more proud of me building that robot on the ground running. I realized I'm not just building a robot, I'm building friendship with her, I'm building a relationship with a student who I work with. So, and Tammy's gonna share more about her experience in this program.
So this program really changed and impacted our team. We used to be a really success-driven team. We always wanted to build the best robot. We want to, you know, win the competition. We always have goals, we go after our goal. But then after Unified Robotic, we really get the principle first, it's not about the robot. I still remember how hesitated and how we were sitting there in our first meeting with Delaney, and then we just had this feeling that we gotta do this, this is gonna be awesome. So every Wednesday, we finish our stuff at school, run directly to our lab, pick up the robot, remember our robot, and bring the kids to Roosevelt High School. It was traffic hours right after school. We traveled for quite a while. So there were times that we were late. And I still remember how I stepped through the door and my partner is running to me. Tammy, Tammy, you here? Why are you so late? You have to be responsible. And then it's true. It teaches me a lesson. So I say, yeah, I will become a responsible partner. And that is one goal that Taylor already has in his mind, is that Tammy, would you help me to build a robot that will win? So it has been pretty, you know, stressful for me a little bit. But then we worked together really well. Then we discussed a lot about robot. Like, we're gonna discuss about the design, where we would put the little Lego figure as our pilot, where he's gonna sit so he can see everything. And we changed our robot name a lot. The beginning, it was Alien, because Taylor thing it looked like an alien. Then it became Taylor Tackler, because we do BattleBot. And then by the end, it was really close to Christmas. It was before Christmas break. So we decided to name it Red and Green Christmas Tiger. Red and Green Christmas Tiger did not really win the whole competition by the end, but just seeing Taylor and his happiness and how proud he was about his robot, how he was describing the robot to everyone, that was the best moment that I've learned and I've got from Unified Robotics, and it meant a lot to me, and I believe that it did the same thing to many of other members in our team.
So as all of them have mentioned, I have a sister with special needs. She's diagnosed with autism, and she's always been a huge fan of our robotics team, and she loves FRC competitions. So every time that she can, she'll come to one of our competitions. And so I wanted to see if there was a program that she could be involved in similar to what we have here, and we weren't able to find anything. So that's essentially kind of how I got this idea. We figured out that there isn't really a robotics club for students with special needs that where they can take control of the robot and they have lots of say and they're building their own robot. So that's how I got the idea for Unified Robotics.
And there's this one thing that I really want to add on, is that we were always about robot. We were always about, you know, getting good grades, going to good colleges, pursuing this like huge achievement of success. But then after Unified Robotics, after I saw them, I worked with them, I got to know them, I realized that the most important thing, not just only about robotics or FIRST, but also about life, is not really about being the best or winning everything or getting stuff for ourselves. It's really how I'm gonna get the knowledge that I learned in FIRST, in all of the things that I've learned in my life, and help and contribute and bring it to other people. I will not just talk to people about FIRST. We want to try like people also experience FIRST and know what we are doing.
I'm going to go off track a little bit and tell you more about Tammy and Taylor. So Taylor knew that I was in charge of this thing, and he would come up to me every Wednesday. Mrs. Foster, are you sure that Tammy is capable of helping me build this winning robot? Yes, Tammy is a very talented robot designer. She can help you. But every week he asked, and it was really cute. Okay, so as we've said, Delaney was inspired by Special Olympics and their Unified Sports Clubs. And I don't know if you've heard what Unified Sports are or if they're at your high school, but it's a special needs program, a special education program that Special Olympics has, where an equal number of participants that have disabilities and don't have disabilities will compete together on the field of play. And so that's what we wanted, because that's a model that has worked really well for sports, and we knew that if we paired the students with special needs in one-on-one with the students that are peer mentors, that we could ensure that they're all going to be learning and going at the right pace. So I'll let you know now. If I'm talking about our robotics team, the CyberKnights here, I refer to them as peer mentors. So that's what all of you will be. And when I talk about the special education community, I will refer to them as students. So, we brought this program to Special Olympics Washington to see if they would be interested. And I wasn't sure how they would receive that, being as Special Olympics is all about physical sports. But they loved the idea right from the very beginning and were super enthusiastic about it. I did not need to persuade them and explain how it's worked for the mind. They got it. And it fits perfectly in their mission. It promotes social inclusion. It builds leadership and leadership skills and confidence. And it was also an outlet for Special Olympics to reach out to a population of students that they weren't reaching. Because there are students that are not interested in playing basketball and soccer. And those are the students that we really wanted to reach out to. So Special Olympics then decided that in Washington, that unified robotics would become one of their sports. So it is now listed as unified sports program. And it had invited us to Microsoft to this corporate sponsor summit where we got to meet with top executives from huge companies that support Special Olympics. And you know, we actually, our students, peer mentors, were able to talk with CEO of Coca-Cola and Toyota and Mattel and Toys R Us, and everybody really received the program great. So we realized that there's a huge need for this, and we need to, you know, not just spread it in Washington, but get it out all over the world.
Okay, so we have guidebooks that Andrew will be passing out to everyone, and unfortunately we do not have enough for everyone that showed up, so you'll have to share with someone next to you. But at unifiedrobotics.org you can find downloads if you need to get those once you go back home. So these guidebooks kind of shows a little bit more about the program, the details of it, and shows you how to get this program at your school, and kind of like what you need to go through, and gives some tips and advice, and kind of shows like if you don't quite know if this is something that you can do, it kind of shows that it is possible no matter what school you go to or where you're from. So my mom and I will be going through each part of this guidebook once they have been all passed out, and just kind of explaining the steps on how to get this program.
So the first thing is you need to present the idea of unified robotics to your team and to your robotics coach, because it's important that you've got the commitment to follow through with the program if this is something you want to do. And then you find your school's special education director or a special ed teacher, an inclusion manager. You know, any teacher in your school can help direct you to that person if you don't know who it is, and tell them about unified robotics. And I guarantee they'll be very interested in it because they want their students to have inclusive activities. Then you register online at unifiedrobotics.org, and you send us your team logo and your high school logo so that we can put you on the website also. This is going to be everybody's website to use. And then a student lead from your team or your coach will meet with the special ed director, go over logistics, what day you're going to meet, what time, location. And then this spring, it's really ideal if you could present this program to your school's principal and the ASB club so that they can be up and rolling, and by fall everything will be in place.
So kind of like what my mom said, it's important to get this going, start communicating about this in spring. So whether you are someone who is really into this program and is ready to start this coming fall, it would be good if you can start meeting with the special education director and your robotics coach so that everyone is on the same page and is wanting to have this program. So that's in the spring. And then another thing that's important to do in the spring, because once summer hits, most people are hard to reach, is to start marketing this club. And one thing that's important is that the students with special needs know about this club, so that and are really, really encouraged to join it, because they're probably going to be very hesitant, thinking that they've never done anything like this before. And so, like, with some students on our team, we kind of just encourage them to show up for the first meeting, see how you like it, and then if this is something you want to do, you can continue. And every single person who showed up for the first meeting was really, really into the program and continued. So encouragement is a big thing, and getting the word out there. So something that we did was we passed out these flyers. So this is just an example of what we had made to the special education director, and then he gave them to the special ed teachers, who then kind of marketed this to the students in their classes. And that was very successful, but it's something that should start in the spring, kind of like right before the year ends, and then reintroduce it when school gets back in the fall before the program, in order to keep kind of marketing it and pushing it in the school. So, because we really want to make sure that it's the students who aren't normally exposed to robotics that are being exposed to this. And it's mixing two groups who don't typically interact much in a high school.
To follow up with that, you know, to be honest, recruiting the students was not really easy, because like a lot of high school students, they didn't know what robotics was. They didn't know that it was a sport, and they did not understand that it was something that they could do. I can't, you know, I've never taken computer science, or I've never taken engineering, or I'm not at all interested in anything like that. And, you know, we just kept being really encouraging and just come to this first meeting. And there was one girl that was particularly shy, and she definitely wanted nothing to do with robots, but she is a good photographer. So I asked her if she would be the team photographer and come and take some video and some photos. And she went to that first meeting, and I don't know if she held her camera for 5 minutes. I mean, it went down and she joined right in, so. Okay, materials. Your club will have several mini teams, and a team consists of one or two peer mentors, or two or three peer mentors and two or three students, so 4 to 6 people on a team. And together, your team will be creating a robot. So in your school, you'll have lots of those robots that will be competing in the tournament. We use the Lego Mindstorms or NXT kits, and so you will need one of those for each team. And they come with software that needs to be downloaded onto a computer, so you'll also need a desktop or a laptop computer that can take that software to be used for this. And you'll need a space to do it. And we recommend either like a cafeteria table, like a round table was perfect, that's what we did for each team, or a cluster of desks.
Kind of to add on to what my mom was saying, many of you probably don't have these, but the Mindstorm kits or the laptops in your school. And right now we're working on fundraisers to help sponsor teams to get them the kits so that they can have the program. So it's the materials that aren't holding them back. And so if you have the kits available, it would be great if you could use that. But if not, that's something that we would love to know, and we can help you get the kits and laptops. And so, as my mom had mentioned earlier, we're now working with Special Olympics on this program. So they will be helping us with purchasing NXT kits for teams. So they'll essentially be like a lending library for you guys. And Microsoft is donating some surfaces to Special Olympics, and they will be able to give those to schools in need. So for the timeline, so we have our kickoff event. So it'll be broadcasting a game that hasn't been made yet, but around to all the teams. And that will be on October October 10th, this fall. And then at the end, we're going to be having a championship tournament on December 3rd. And so in the Pacific Northwest, we're going to try to have an inter-school competition. But if you're not from the Pacific Northwest, and you can get unified robotics in schools near you, it would be awesome if you could also have an inter-school competition on the same day. And we're working with Special Olympics as they're used to this kind of tournament style competition, and they can help us in the future kind of figure out how we can have a big, huge competition. And so the build season is actually going to be 8 weeks, and this is because this is our first year doing this with multiple schools, and we want to make sure that if a student hears about it later in the game, that they can still join and still have time to finish their robot. So that's why there's like an extra week in there. And then also, we really encourage you to have your first meeting be like a meet and greet kind of meeting. Provide pizza and soda and kind of get in your teams, come up with team names and team cheers. That's always really fun. And kind of play some icebreaker games to really get to know the students that you're working with before you dive in and start building a robot. So that's essentially what the schedule would be.
So for a couple of things that I guess I forgot earlier, one is we are going to do a webinar and also in the Pacific Northwest and then host a training session. So if you can't get to Seattle, then it will be broadcast and we will have some special education teachers from different high schools giving tips. So I encourage you to watch that or connect with your own special education teachers in your own high school. Another thing is you might be from a school that does not have a special education population. That was the case with our school. So we connected with a local public school and went there. So if that is the case, you can say that on your registration form, but also contact us and we will help find a school in your location, you know, preferably one that doesn't have a first team, because then you'll also be bringing FIRST in robotics to a new high school. And if all the schools in your area have FIRST teams, then we really encourage that you join together and share resources and do this together. Okay, so there's lots of tips. They're listed in there. One thing is adopt some respectful language. I hope that you all don't use the R word. I hope that you all know what I'm talking about. That's a word that's extremely offensive and hurtful, not just for people with special needs, but all the people that love them. We also don't like to define people by a disability. I don't want my daughter defined as the autistic kid. She's a person, she's a woman, she's a student, and she also is diagnosed with autism. And try not to describe people that way. And a really common thing that was a challenge for us, probably because of me, I call all of you guys kids. And sometimes some of our peer mentors would refer to the kids they're working with. And that is something that we absolutely don't want to have done. These are students, they're the same age as you, they might be older than you. In the special education department, public schools, students can remain in a transition program until they're 21. So you may be working with young adults. And this is not just bringing STEM to this population, you're also bringing social skills and some basic life skills, and you'll want to encourage appropriate school behavior, which is probably not hugging. And I know a lot of people like to hug, but in the school environment, it is more appropriate to give a high five. And sometimes that needs to be reiterated every single week with the partner that you're working with. I encourage you to reach out to your community. We sent out some press releases, and on our website, we've got links to a template for that. When we had our final competition, we had 150 people people about that were there. NPR came and broadcast it. We had a lot of newspapers, so we sent our press releases out to everybody, including the local neighborhood blogs, so that just community members that didn't even have high school students were there. And that was a really cool way to spread awareness of the program. T-shirts up there. We printed T-shirts, and that's something that, you know, is really fun. Our Unified Robotics logo that is in also the guidebook and online. You print it in whatever your school colors are or your team colors. So we have it in black. The school we worked with, their colors were green and yellow, so that's what our T-shirts look like. So you adopt the logo to look like your school. And just really encourage you to, you know, as you bring these students in, because a lot of them may not have any prior interest in robotics, you know, but to take it step by step, to go at their pace, stay at their level, and get them excited about robots, about technology. And oh, one last thing that's really important, stay in contact. The season's only 6 to 8 weeks long, and then there's going to be winter break, but you have made a new friend, and you are going to be very, very important in that person's life. So sit with them at lunch, invite them to do something, because it's a relationship I can assure you that you will cherish.
Okay, so Andrew has developed a website, unifiedrobotics.org, and there is lots of information on there for you guys, and he'll tell you a little bit of what's on there and what you can find there.
So on the Unified Robotics website, there's a lot of information. There's like how we started. There's the guidebook there online. You can also print it out. You have the registration form there, so if you want to sign up, you can go and do that. And there's also something called a style guide, where it covers like the logos, what sizes you can use the logos, what fonts to use, colors, etc. So those who are really wanting to know about that, we have those. And is there anything else?
Yeah,
and register.
So do you guys have any questions for us?
So comparing your experience with mine as a scoutmaster, I've had scouts with special needs, and I found that those with Asperger's can be prone to some pretty dramatic emotional outbursts. And I found it really helpful to have somebody present who has some history with the scout that I can call on, who knows how to help them calm down. I'm wondering if you've had any of that sort of experience, and if a teacher or a parent or something like that is present to help you out.
Well, of course we've had that experience. So yeah, people with intellectual disabilities and special needs can have some behavior challenges. And I can talk about this real freely because it's my daughter who often does. So I was there, of course, to be with her. But a lot of the parents of the students would come and watch. They loved the program. So they were nearby. And also Tom Levy, the special education director, he was there every week. So he's there to help us. We don't want to remove any student from the program, but if we can identify what has caused that emotional outbreak, then we can support them and pull away from it.
So, I can talk loud. My school doesn't have like the small robotics team yet, so would you suggest like starting a program with that first, and then like working into getting something like this to happen? Or do you think we could make it happen just all at once?
So your school...
Like, we do FRC, so we do the big robots.
Okay.
So
what you're telling me is you don't have those kits.
Correct.
You have a robotics team.
Yeah, we don't do these kits at all.
Okay.
So do you think we should start with that first and do a year or two to get used to it, and then get the special needs kids involved?
No, those kids, they have instructions, you can build what the instructions tell you, but you can also modify it and take it to, you know, way more complex levels. So you'll find that you're working with students of all different abilities and you'll have a little bit of everything going on. If you don't have those kits, that's why we are trying to raise money, and in Special Olympics Washington has committed to buying kits for any school that needs them. So what state are you from?
Pennsylvania.
So I will connect with the Special Olympics Pennsylvania director and let them know.
I'm Mike Thompson, the head coach. And we had other schools from the area send representatives from their unified club system. So we had students with special needs and their partners would come. And nine times out of ten, their partners had never even seen a Lego kit. So one of the reasons why we chose the Lego is it is so easy and quick to pick up. The software and the instructions are very straightforward. So these students that came in that had never even touched a Lego kit within a day or two, we're online, up and running, and working directly with their unified club partner. So it was very, very easy to come up to speed.
My name is Lisa. I'm a head coach of a varsity team in Maine. I'm also a special education teacher. We do FLL currently to help feed into our FRC team. Does this unified schedule run on the same schedule as FLL, so we would be in that same timeline?
What is the FLL schedule?
It seems like it's about the same time, but...
Yeah, it is the same time. I don't know if FLL meets every day or when they meet.
It depends on the team, I'm sure.
Okay, yeah. So, for Unified Robotics, it's only meeting once a week for about an hour to an hour and a half, so it's not that big of a time commitment for the members on the team. So hopefully it wouldn't, you'd be able to kind of like pick the day of the week that you don't need to meet with your FLL, and then you could be meeting with Unified Robotics. So it's up to you to schedule which day of the week is best for your school, your team, and the students with special needs.
In the back. I'm from Canada, and so our education system is a little bit different. Could you explain to me what ASB Club is?
So I'm a teacher at Roosevelt High School, a local teacher. ASB is, and I'm from Indiana. So ASB is specific to Washington State. It's just the approval process for a publicly funded school.
Okay. And when you met with Special Olympics, I'm already involved with Special Olympics Canada because I too have a special needs daughter. Did Washington say that all Special Olympics would be interested in this, or do I have to go through the process with Special Olympics Canada?
The director of Special Olympics Washington, which is who we met with, was so enthusiastic. He's been with Special Olympics International in Washington, D.C. for like 15 years. He just recently came to Washington. So he's got a ton of international relationships, and I would say it's probably best if I connect with him and have him connect directly with Special Olympics in Canada to get them to support the program also. What part of Canada?
In the blue.
So you guys built a really good relationship with the Special Olympics in your state. I'm wondering how you precisely did that so you implemented it in Minnesota.
Okay, so I personally just...
Repeat the question because I don't think they can hear.
Oh, okay. So she asked that we have now made a connection with Special Olympics in our state and was wondering how we did that so that they could do that in their own state. So I connected with
Special Olympics, and they had heard about what we're doing just through the news. We were in a lot of local news, and so I kind of just set up a meeting with the CEO, told him what we were doing, and in that first meeting he was very interested. But like what my mom said, he used to work in the international office, and he had lots of connections with the CEOs of the other states. So when you write down your information up there at the end of this meeting, just let us know what city and state you're from, and we will connect with the CEO of Special Olympics in that state and help you guys build that relationship so that you're bringing it to the other states.
So, you know, like she said, just that we will try to connect you, but we're not going to prevent you from going to your own Special Olympics. Definitely go, be an advocate, tell them about the program. That way they'll actually be hearing, seeing a person right there in a school, right in their neighborhood.
Yeah, Delaney basically cold called the CEO of the local Special Olympics, set up the meeting. So go for it.
Okay, question. Sorry. So cool that you guys are doing this. Absolutely. So I'm a special education teacher, 6th and 7th graders, but I'm a mentor for the robotics team. So lots of different questions. I would assume that the building of the robot, if you were to spoke to this, is not the whole gist of the thing. Because, you know, we have a span of special education students, moderately impaired, severely impaired, and I would imagine that somebody can be paired up to be a really perfect peer mentor for everyone, right? So I think that's key. So I'm totally excited. Cool that you guys have set up like this booklet, the version one. I would imagine more versions are going to be coming. And set up this gateway and everything. So really, really cool. Totally excited. I guess my biggest question is, and we don't have any of the Lego kits or anything like that either. And I'm looking at this timeline here. It's kind of spring already, right? So how quickly do you think we could get our hands on something like that and get our peer mentors familiar with the kits? I'm thinking actually having them visit the special education classrooms and having working models, I think, would be the best way to show something so it's a concrete thing that's out kind of thing.
Well, if you're in a school that it's late spring and you're going to be out in May, then, you know, doing it right away is probably not crucial. I think that spreading the word early is important, but we don't start until October 3rd, so your school then probably starts a little bit earlier. And so there is time in that first month.
And I think regarding just the training and wrap up with the Lego kits, it's very quick. As I mentioned, there were high school students that had never seen one before and never thought of robotics. And literally within a day, they were building and they were programming. So that's the beauty of the Lego. Did you know of other teams in the nation that have tried this, for instance, with Tetrix and other platforms? Were a big fan of Lego just simply because of accessibility. Also, a lot of special ed programs use Lego for fine motor movement skills. You mentioned the broad spectrum. I had the privilege of working with a young lady who's, Tammy talked about what does success mean. The student I was working with, success meant for her after a couple weeks to simply connect two pieces. And I think for me, I'm a teacher, an ex-engineer, and FRC mentor. I think one of the things that impacted me most about the program was watching this young lady and the tenacity and her drive. She would sit there for 20 minutes and struggle to put a peg in a hole, and she would not give up. And I would look at her and go, you know, if half of us were like you, can you imagine what the world would be like? So it deeply impacted me. I learned my craft, my teaching craft. I learned a lot from this mentor teacher, the special ed teacher. I learned a lot about how to teach from the program, so it was very valuable for me also. One thing I want to toss out, there's lots of hands. The incidence of Asperger's autism is rising radically, and industry is recognizing this. And And Microsoft, for instance, has started a new hiring process for neurodiversity. They have a completely parallel program now for hiring people with Asperger's and on the autism spectrum. So industry is recognizing the need for this, and that's one of the reasons why Microsoft is so interested in supporting it and getting this. They would like to see a pipeline developed for students all the way from the high school age on up through, so that these students that they recognize are incredibly creative and capable now have the vision and a pipeline for them to get into a productive life.
I'm a coach for Team 438 with Robotics in Fort Collins, Colorado. And I was wondering, what is the relationship between the peer mentors and the students when it becomes FRC build season?
So even though when it gets to FRC season, we are really busy, but sometimes we can still find time to bring our friends over to show them around the lab and everything. And also, our team would send out updates to their parents or their guardian who would like be in touch with them and let them know. And also, it was really exciting for us that we had them at our local meets and district meet. They were really excited. We have our jersey ready for them. They're like, yeah, that's my team down there. That's Ben, that's my friend. So, you know, it's gonna come back. Yes, when you have RC season, maybe try to let them feel first, experience first.
And the Iron Riders back here are working with us, and they chose to delay their entry into the program until after FRC season. And while we put up a schedule up here, I think the bottom line is we want the program to happen. We don't want this to be our program, we want this to be everybody's program. We've trademarked the name Unified Robotics. That's actually being picked up and transferred to Special Olympics. We want this program to go. And just like Delaney basically just had the idea, cold called, and got it up and running, that's what we want you all to do. That's what FIRST is. We want you to just get out there and make it happen, build these connections, and we want to have a national structure that can maybe start to tie this together. But bottom line, we want this to happen and just get going.
Okay.
So we had a mic back here.
Already.
Yep.
It sounds like that so far Unified Robotics has primarily been in the high school. Have you done any work with the younger kids, junior high, elementary, or do you think that that might be something that might be included in the future?
I think that it can definitely grow that way. We started in high school because we are high schoolers, and my daughter with autism is also a high schooler. As a parent, the programs get fewer and fewer as the kids get older. Students get older. So I know that in elementary school there were a lot more opportunities for people to do things like this, and that just kind of started dropping off as she got older. So I think there's a huge need for it at the high school level, and that transition age level that will also be in the high schools.
How did you get students to originally come to the FIRST meeting if they weren't really robotics people, because they don't know about it and they don't know what technology really is?
Well, we pestered them. And they would say, well, I don't like robotics. I don't know what robotics is. And I'd say, well, do you like board games? You know, is that fun to compete with your family? Like, yeah. Like, do you like going to like soccer games and cheering and, you know? And they're like, yeah. I'm like, then you're gonna love it. Because, you know, that's what it is. And a lot of them are just nervous. They can't do it. So just keep saying, you will be working one-on-one with a peer mentor, and you'll be partnered with that person the whole time, and they're going to teach you every step of the way.
And also, that's something that your special education director at your school can help you with as well. Just tell them that you want this program to be for everyone, no matter what their ability is, and he will or she will help you get that going and really help encourage the students.
Right here. Okay. Thank you so much for all you're doing. I want to expand a little bit on the comment about the spectrum being very broad. So it really sounds like what you're doing is really addressing students that are already might be served by Special Olympics. Obviously, that connection is very tight. Do you have either experience or some comments on inclusion into the general FRC or FIRST robotics programs, where those on the spectrum that, you know, have a role that they can play or serve in the team could be in, for instance, the FRC team if they're of that age. Any comments on that, please?
Well, I think absolutely. If the student can keep up with the pace of the FRC competition, and they want to be on the team, I think that's great. We had a range of students from the young woman that Mr. Thompson worked with, who by the end of the 6 weeks, she had a little bar with six pegs in it, each had a gear on it so she could spin them around, and she learned something. Mm-hmm. So that was meaningful for her. We also had students that discovered hidden potentials. They were extremely talented and very creative, and they thought of things that our mentors had not thought of. So those students, you know, I would definitely encourage, get on to that next level.
Okay.
We also think that what I'd love to see is some unified robotics teams actually segue into FTC. The pacing there is, I think, more accommodating. So ultimately, I see for an actual team coming out constructed like unified robotics, I see FTC, First Tech Challenge, excuse me, as probably a better format for that. I know there are many FRC teams that have students with special needs on them, which is amazing and wonderful. But one of our goals is to allow these students to take the lead and take the ownership, and that might be a little easier in something like First Tech Challenge.
I was just going to comment that we do have several students on our team, our FRC team, and that has gone well. Like you said, they've found talents they didn't know they had, web design, we have some programming, just build, and it's been something that's really opened them up, and they're accepted by the other students. Nobody thinks too much any different, which is what we all want, and that's been a fantastic addition to our team. It's been a challenge because none of us have had any training, so we do, as you've said, have somebody that's got some prior history with them, typically a parent that is able to be there to help us out when we do have any additional needs that we have not been trained for.
I am really impressed with teams like yours, and several other coaches have come up and said, well, you know, our team is all inclusive and we already have students with a variety of special needs on our team. And so if we had unified robotics at our school, do we have to force them off the team? Isn't that degrading? We don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. And it's no, they are on your team. They are the peer mentors. They are going to now be the leaders. And the point of unified robotics is to get out and find those students with special needs that don't know about robotics yet and don't have any hands-on experience. Find them or recruit them in.
So my name is Andy. I'm the Dean of Admissions and Financial Aid at WPI. And I'm so thrilled professionally, but also personally. I've mentored several individuals with special needs, as well as my mother's been a special education teacher my whole life. So I think this is incredible. But from a professional standpoint, we use the Mindstorm kits in our summer programs, our academic year programs. So I'm curious, how can colleges who may have access to not just this technology, but, you know, 10% of our student body has been through FIRST. We have students who care about giving back to their community, who want to be engaged in things like this. How do you see colleges fitting into unified robotics, and how can we connect our resources or our students that are already on campus that might have expertise or interest with unified robotics with Special Olympics?
So I think there's many ways in order for that to happen. If your college is near a public high school that, or a private high school that already has a FIRST robotics team, I would encourage the students from the college to go in and talk to the robotics team and get interest in them, and then maybe they can help take a lead to connect them with their special education department and get the program going at that school. So they kind of act in like a mentor role, kind of like how my mom helped me connect those two programs. Other ways is if there are any populations. One thing that my mom kind of briefly mentioned earlier, but as the older you get, the least amount of opportunities you get if you have special needs. So
especially starting in high school, it kind of starts dropping out. And that's why Special Olympics now has the unified program. But now there really isn't too much for individuals with special needs after they finish high school. So something that would be good is finding a special education in your community who are adults and connecting with them and bringing unified robotics to adults as well. That was something Microsoft was also really interested in. This man right up here.
Our team, Girls on Fire, we're actually from North Carolina, and I have full intention of starting one of these at my high school. We actually are merged with a special needs middle school, and I was actually wondering if you would recommend that parents and even the special needs teachers would be in the classroom along with the meetings.
Yes, we had the special education director at the school that we were working with at all of our meetings, since he knows the students really well, and in case anything ever happened, he was there to step in. Also, like, a lot of students have aides or like nannies that are with them after school, and so there were some students who had an adult with them, and so I encourage people to bring in those people to kind of help with that aspect. And then we had mentors on our team who helped out. I mean, our head coach worked with one of the students, kind of the same as all the students, so.
Hi there, my name is Carla Crew. I work for FIRST. And first of all, I want to applaud Delaney and Noel and the group. This team through their great diversity efforts in creating gender parity on their team and being a Society of Women Engineers grant winner. So that was my first introduction to this team. And then I got a nice note from Delaney telling me what she was doing, and I was blown away by it. And so I applaud you and encourage you to keep going with what you're doing. But for all the team members that are in the audience, and for the parents who may have a special needs child, I would like to ask one of these ladies in the middle. Oh yeah, putting you right on the spot. And the second half would be to Noel. I'm using the guise of what I thought and what I got. What was it like to say, okay, I'm going to do this, and you go in with a preconceived notion of what you thought it was going to be, and what you came away with, and what you learned yourselves. And then for Noel, you know, what, same thing, what you thought this was going to be, and what kind of impact did it have on you as a mom? I think that would, people would be, I know the story, and I love hearing your, you know, your feedback, but I think everybody here needs to kind of hear that personal side of what you're doing.
So that's a very big question. I really come into the program with no thoughts because I really don't know what should I expect to happen. I don't know what student I'm going to work with, but I definitely would not thought of I will build such amazing friendship and I will learn so much from them. Like, I think you guys have heard a lot that what we've been doing, but honestly, I think I have received the most for doing this program. As I kind of said earlier, like, I was a very control person. When I was in a group project, I liked to take the lead. But this program really helped me to how to be a supporter, just step back, and you know, sometimes make your team even better just to doing that. And I learned how, like Mr. Thompson was talking about, never gave up. Like, there's so many times in the middle, I was like, she's so distracted, like, we can't get this done on time, but she never gave up, I never gave up, and look at what we've done. We built a robot that is running on the ground. There's just so many things I have learned from her, how she's positive, and like, she encouraged me all the time, so yeah. I think this program really made me to look at the world in a different angle.
So I could go on and on and on with Carla's question. But what I expected, probably like all of you FRC students,
the Cyber Knights are very respectful. They're good kids. I knew that they would be polite and empathetic. I knew that it would be a successful program. I did not know that they were going to develop the relationships that they developed. I did not know that they would be so excited for Wednesday afternoon. And I did not know that we would then have students with special needs wearing our jerseys and coming to our meets. And right now, their teacher is getting the live feed of the competitions here. I mean, it's they really got into that. I didn't expect it to have that kind of impact. And personally, as a mom, Kendall gets really distracted academically and doesn't make a lot of progress. He's not interested in a lot of things, very interested in some things. And she would try to distract Eva, as Eva had said. And I watched her and I watched step by step, and Kendall's following directions and getting it. And then one day, I think Eva was having a hard time with Kendall getting, actually two on the software. And Eva used language that it was brilliant. She said, "Kendall, come on, let's teach your robot how to do tricks." And bing, Kendall's like, "Oh!" And ta-da, she's programming a robot to do several things. So I had no idea that Kendall would have that capability or that interest. And then I was just recently talking to another mother, and it happened to be the mother, the young woman that Mr. Thompson worked with, that really struggled. She was nonverbal, and the success with her was connected to this. And when I was talking to her mother, said, "We didn't think that she would like it. We didn't think she'd get anything out of it, but she was so excited for Wednesday. She loved it. And we were so afraid that she would be a burden to this team and that she would take up a whole person's time." And it's not at all. I mean, this girl taught us so much and changed us so much watching her. She gets so excited. So.
Unfortunately, it is 11:30, past 11:30, and that's when our conference is over, and I believe there's one coming in after this. That's kind of why I really need to wrap it up. But just so you guys know, before you leave, up here we have business card, my business card. If you have any questions, please email me, and I will get back to you as soon as I can. And then we have buttons and brochures that kind of explain a little bit more. We have our style guide up here and samples of our flyer. And then we have a sign-up sheet. If you could just kind of write where you're from, write your name and your email, that would be awesome. And then really quickly, we are having a fundraiser to help sponsor kits and laptops. And obviously this event is going to be at my school in Seattle, Washington, and most of you are not from Seattle, Washington. But we have a registration link, and that's on our website. And when you register, it's $15 and it comes with a free t-shirt. And so if you are interested in helping support this program, you can still register and not show up and get a t-shirt for $15.
We brought some t-shirts.
And we brought some t-shirts here if it's something you're interested in doing right now before you go home. So just really quickly, if you guys are interested in getting more information, write your email down and come get some of this and register online on unifiedrobotics.org. And feel free to email me with any questions you have. Thank you.
Register, we brought some red t-shirts, like the one I'm wearing. And this is Kendall. And so they're out there on the floor. And I know there's one not for everybody.